Axe or ask, Donda's rules suit shoes. McClendonReport.com.
Sing your song as if you were singing for 1,000 people. Always give your best on your job and at home. Tonight we celebrate excellence and faith with recording artist and minister Joanne Rosario. Tonight she discusses her new album, her tragic voice loss, and her life restored by faith. Inspiration is on the menu tonight on Gerard McClendon Live. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. Are you hoping for something big? Do you truly want the desires of your heart? Tonight on Gerard McClendon Live, prepare to be inspired by a special guest. She is a national music director for Maranatha Ministries and a top-selling recording artist on Verity Records. Welcome to our show tonight, Ms. Joanne Rosario. Thank you for joining us.
It is a pleasure. A pleasure to be here.
Wow, just got off the airplane, scooped in on Gerard McClendon Live. Hey, we appreciate you. I want to start things off by asking you this. I saw you at a concert not too long ago, and you made it perfectly clear before you even started singing, Joanne, that this wasn't about just entertaining people. It's much more than that. Can you explain?
Honestly, my God, I've been so blessed in the way I've been raised. I've been, you know, a pastor's daughter since the beginning. And I'm not an entertainer. I'm not gifted enough. People may see me sing and they're, oh, you know, great talent, but I'm really not gifted enough to be an entertainer.
Yeah.
Like when you look at Beyonce, she's an entertainer. She knows how to put on a show. She's excellent at what she does.
Yes.
If I'm put in the position to have to do that, I would freeze, I get nervous, but there's something about when I stand out on stage and before I walk out there and I say, God, let the people see you and not me. Let the people see Jesus and not me, that you feel his spirit come on you, and that's what gives me really, honestly, the boldness to be able to go out there and do what I do.
When did you know that you had this gift to sing and to touch people?
I think as far as the talent is concerned, I've been singing since I was 3. It wasn't until I was around 15 that I realized that not everybody can listen to the radio and imitate what they hear.
Right.
And it wasn't until I got a little bit older that I really realized that it was just something different.
Yeah.
That I would sing and people would begin to cry. And, you know, throughout my life, I think God little by little has been showing me that everything that I have, from my image to my height to my voice, it's all a tool to bring people into the kingdom. It's all a tool to share the gospel of Jesus Christ and his love for the world, not just for Christians, but for everyone, from the worst sinner to the most perfect saint.
You know, speaking of the gospel, and I was reading your, something on your website earlier this week. You said living a life without worry. Now, come on, Joanne, come on. How can we live without worries? We got bills to pay.
Yes.
There's tragedy happening. There's stock markets crashing. How can a person live a life without worry, Joanne?
The word of God, we have to come to the point where we understand that it is true. And really, really believe it. A lot of people are Christians and we read the Bible and we read the Word of God, but we don't really understand that it's true. The Word of God says, you know, with God, nothing is impossible. It says, be anxious for nothing, but by prayer and supplication, making your request known unto God with thanksgiving, he will do what he needs to do. And then on top of that, he gives you peace. So it's an exercise of learning how to bring every situation and every circumstance to the feet of Jesus and say, you promised me that you would take care of me. You promised me. So you know what? I'm going to say like Jesus, I mean, not like Peter said, I'm going to get out of the boat because you said come.
Yes.
I'm going to step out and I'm going to trust that you got me. But the great thing about him is even when you have a moment of doubt and you begin to sink in that water, even if he says, oh, ye of little faith, he's going to grab you and hold you back up.
So even when things look perilous, the key is to maintain that faith. Hold on tight to that faith.
And even when you feel like you're letting go of that faith, just say, God, help me. In all honesty, he knows the moment of weakness.
Speaking of honesty,
yes.
Now your music
your lyrics have always been open and honest, and you let it all out. I've noticed when you sing, sometimes you may just start crying in the middle of the song, or you may get overwhelmed or overcome by what? What's overwhelming you during a song?
A lot of times I'm thinking about everything that God has brought me through. I have not had the perfect life. I haven't always made all the perfect decisions. I haven't earned anything in my walk with God, and I realize that every opportunity that He gives me to sing, even like this opportunity to be here and to talk to the people, it's by the grace of God, and because He has shown His love to me, His love has brought me to repentance, His love has brought me into a life of holiness, His love has brought me into relationship, and that's just a different type of walking with God.
Yeah, yeah. You know, you've been through a lot. I want to share with the audience my wilderness experience. I had seminoma cancer, and I lost my voice for 6 months, and it was a devastating period in my life. I had surgery on my chest. You know, I believe they're showing the photo now. Thank God I had a good wife. She nursed me back to health.
Wow.
You know, but I lost my voice, and it was restored. Joanne Rosario lost her voice. Now, when a vocalist loses their voice, what do you do? Do you panic? Do you break the contract with the record company? Do you say, God, why? I mean, what happened? You lost your voice. Tell the story.
I said, God, why? I went through depression. I went through anger. I went through confusion. I went through every type of negative emotion that you can think about. And it got to the point where I just really realized, you know what? If God doesn't do it, it's not going to get done. Mm. And I don't mean that as a cliche, but literally, I mean, we go through situations in life, and you know that if God doesn't step into your situation, there's no way that you'll make it through. And I just chilled out.
Yeah.
I would say maybe about 6 months after everything happened, it's like I got to the point where I just relaxed, and I started focusing on trying to be a blessing to other people. And I started focusing on not just having a pity party.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
And right there, little by little, it's like He started showing me what His process was for me during that time of wilderness. Joanne, learn how to live in thanksgiving regardless of the circumstance. Learn to live by faith. Mm. I could not work. Literally, this is my living. This is how I pay my bills. And literally for 6 months straight, I couldn't work. When I tell you God paid every one of my bills. When I tell you that during that year, God put me in my first house.
Mm.
I don't know where the money came. I couldn't tell you where it came from. I couldn't tell you.
Joanne, just hold on tight. I see you got your voice back.
That's good.
Faith moves mountains. Here's your opportunity to speak with Joanne Rosario. Call 630-575-TALK. 630-575-TALK. Gerard McLennan Live continues in a moment.
If depression has your senses in its grasp, just remember these things can't last too long. The God of creation.
Wow, that's Verity Hammond, Zomba gospel recording artist Joanne Rosario, decided to share her gifts with us today on Gerard McLennan Live. She gets off an airplane and drives right down to CLTV. You can't beat that, thanks to Monica, her manager. Hey, Joanne, I'm going straight to some phone calls here.
That's great.
This is excellent. I'm going to go with Dee. Dee, thank you for calling Gerard McLennan Live. You're on the line with Joanne Rosario.
Hi, Ms. Rosario. Thank you for taking my call.
How are you?
Hi. I was just listening to both of your testimonies, and now I kind of feel ashamed asking the question I want to ask. But my question was, I had came to a time where I fell behind in bills and my finances, and I couldn't pay tithes. And I have confessed to the Lord and asked for forgiveness. I want to know, how do I get back to the point where I'm not feeling guilty? I know God forgives us, but my finances are still just so torn, just coming out of debt a little. I'm almost done, but what do we do when we know we've wronged our God with our tithes?
Wow, Dee, thank you so much for calling Gerard McLennan Live.
That's great.
My callers are amazing, Joanne, and this is a serious issue for a lot of people. What do you do in that situation?
Dee, I thank you for calling in and for your bravery. You're amazing. This is a problem that we have in church, because God forgives us, but we don't usually forgive ourselves. The moment that you went to the Lord and said, Lord, please forgive me, I wasn't responsible, I didn't bring my tithe to you, I was going through this situation, he's not a taskmaster, he's a father. And I know that many of us don't have maybe positive relationships with our fathers, and it's hard for us to understand his love for us, but God loves you, and he wants to help you, and he is there to help you, but you do have to forgive yourself, and it's not God that is making you feel condemnation, but it's the enemy. You know, the Holy Spirit will bring you conviction, and you go and you repent, but it's the enemy that even after you've asked the Lord to forgive you, he keeps trying to bring that condemnation, have to, you know what, stand in the authority of a believer through the blood of Jesus and say, devil, you know what? Yeah, you're right, I didn't pay my tithes. Yeah, I did it wrong, but you know what? The blood of Jesus has forgiven me. I have, you know, I've made it right, and from now on, make a commitment that no matter how low your finances go or what happens, you are always gonna take that 10%.
Joanne.
Always take it, you know, and just let the past be the past, be done with it, and move forward, and just allow the blessing of God to come into your life.
Man, thanks, Joanne. I'm sure Dee really appreciates that. I'm going back to the phones. I'm going to Alicia. Alicia, thank you for calling Gerard McClendon Live. You're on the line with Joanne Rosario. Alicia. Alicia, come on. Talk to me, Alicia.
Hi. Hi, Ms. Rosario. Thank you for taking my call.
Hi, how are you?
I'm so blessed by your ministry. I had two quick questions.
Okay.
One, I wanted to ask, I'm a new worship leader. I haven't been doing it that long. I wanted to ask, what's the most important thing that I could implement to keep me in a place where I'm able to usher in the presence of God and also bring the people into worship without being an entertainer, like you said? Because for so many times, I pick my songs according to what the congregation may like and what I know they get into. But I'm changing that. All I want to do is worship God.
What's your second question, Alicia? What's your second question?
My second question is vocal training.
Okay.
What do you do to keep your voice conditioned?
Alicia, thank you for the call. She's talking about what's the most important thing she should do as a leader.
I'm going to answer the second one first because that's the easiest one to answer. You can go to vocalcoach.com. Mm. It is a Christian couple out of Nashville, Tennessee, and they offer CDs for vocal warm-ups, exercises, breathing, and they're not very expensive. I use this just about every day and to do exercises, a lot of water and a lot of rest. So when you got to lead worship on Sunday morning, you make sure you get good rest. Saturday night, you get up early, you do your exercises, you drink a lot of water before you got to go to church because you've got to be hydrated. Going back to your first question, the first thing that you need to do is, one, don't ever pick your songs according to what the people like. Because the song may be in style and it may be what everybody's singing, but it may not be what the Holy Spirit wants to sing that morning. So in your preparation and when you pray and you seek God, a lot of times what I do is I will pray in private. I will pray in the Spirit. I will pray in tongues. I will pray in the Holy Spirit. And a lot of times a song will just come to my mind and I have a piece of paper next to me and I'll write down the song. I'll continue to pray. And I try to stay in line with what the pastor has been bringing. Mm. So if he's been in the flow of holiness, I look for songs that are regarding holiness. If it's about faith, it's like I try to stay in the same spirit as what the pastor is doing. Another thing that's really great with worship leaders is keep a pure heart. Focus on Jesus, but at the same time, don't get so wrapped up in your personal worship that you forget about the people.
Joanne, I'm gonna have to cut you right there, but call us, 630-575-TALK. Joyous Salvation is the new album. More from recording artist Joanne Rosario in 2 minutes. I'm with Joanne Rosario. Welcome back to Gerard McClendon Live. Gospel recording artist Joanne Rosario is hanging out tonight. We appreciate you, Joanne.
Thank you.
That was a great clip. Donnie McClurkin, praising the Lord behind you there. You know, what does that song mean to you?
The name of that song is Satisfy My Soul, and my dad wrote that song. Pastor McClurkin came to minister at our church in Chicago and heard the song and loved it and asked me to come and share. And actually, that day was the first time that I sang at a recording after I had lost my voice. I was so afraid. I was so afraid. I called Pastor and I said, I don't want to do it. And he said, you're going to do it and the anointing is going to show up and you're going to be fine. And I was like, I don't want to do it. And when I tell you that when I watch that, I just see the testimony of God singing through me because my voice was not 100% yet.
That's right.
And he allowed it to come out.
Let's talk about Pastor Nahum and Minerva, your parents.
Aww.
Oh, man. Just briefly, I got to go back to the phones, but let's briefly tell us about Maranatha Ministries.
My God, we have been in the Chicago area for 34 years. I'm a third generation PK. My grandfather was a pastor. My dad is a pastor. And my father was never looking to be a bishop or an apostle or a pastor. He was never looking for it. And God just kind of cornered him and said, this is what I have for you to do. At this point, there are almost 500 churches under the ministry. Actually, last week, he just came back from Zimbabwe. And we all know the political situation that's going on there. It's been very, very difficult. He went there with an offering to take to our church there. Mm. We had built a well for the community, and the walls were crumbling in because of the drought and everything that's been happening, and we were able to restore the well, and the people were excited. And my father went there, and he told them, I believe that something is going to happen with the government. And right after he left, then there was a situation where both parties came into agreement. And I know that that's when we are walking in the authority of establishing the kingdom of God.
Yes.
He didn't go there for the money. He didn't go there for the crowds. He's in a small church and the people are packed in. Mm. But he does it because he loves God and he loves his people.
Joanne, I'm going to Shauna quickly. Shauna, thank you for calling Gerard McClendon Live. What's your comment?
Hi, I just wanted to encourage Joanne. I've been following her since she came to Gary, Indiana, a few years back with Fred Hammond.
Okay.
And you sang at the baseball stadium.
Yes, I remember.
Yes, and nobody really knew who Joanne was, and we were just screaming. I'm not a singer. I'm a praise dancer.
Okay.
And I just wanted to let you know that I do perform, minister to your song more. I love that song. It ministers to my soul every time that I'm going through or I feel I need an outpour of the Holy Spirit. I play more.
Wow.
And I just feel refreshed and renewed. So God has done a tremendous work with you. I send my blessings and encouragement.
Thank you.
You continue to be strong in the Lord and every blessing that you receive.
Wow.
I'm happy for you.
Thank you for the call.
Thank you,
Joanne, for gracing us with your presence. You are truly a blessing. And on behalf of my audience, God bless you.
God bless you.
We love you.
We love you.
Stay tuned for my interview with Tim Reed and Tom Dreesen. Joanne's beautiful voice takes us to break. More Gerard McClendon Live shortly. Guess who I ran into today? Tim Reed and Tom Dreesen with columnist and commentator Ron Rappaport. The three of them have a new book out called Tim and Tom, an American Comedy in Black and White. The gentleman kicked it with me on Michigan Avenue. Check it out. Tim Reed, let's talk about this book just a little bit. I mean, you've been in you know, stardom for quite a while. We've seen you in WKRP in Cincinnati, Sister Sister. Talk to me about your relationship and partnership with Tom.
Well, it goes way back. We celebrate our 40th year in show business next year. And we started out as two people in Chicago area, hoping to have a career in show business many, many years ago. And we stuck together for about 5.5 years. But the whole thing is that right here in Chicago is where it all started. And thanks to the wonderful people here, we were able to build a career.
Yeah, yeah. Tom, a black comedian, a white comedian, hooking up, you know, late 60s, early 70s. What was that like?
Well, first of all, we weren't a black comedian and a white comedian. We were two guys. He was the salesman, and I was selling life insurance. He was working for DuPont. And we were lecturing on drugs to grade school children, teaching grade school children the ills of drug abuse. And one day, a little eighth grade girl said, you guys are funny. You ought to become a comedy team. We went, whoa, let's try that. And so we became America's first black and white comedy team. And it turns out we were America's last black and white comedy team.
Yeah. Let's talk about unrest. What was that like, though? Because, you know, there was a torrential time period, late 60s, early 70s. People probably couldn't get with this vibe at first. What was it like, Tim?
Well, it was a tough environment for sure. I mean, we were going through Vietnam anti-war demonstrations, we're a sexual revolution, a drug revolution. We just lost two great leaders in Dr. King and Robert Kennedy. You know, Fred Hampton was assassinated a year or so later. And so the world was in turmoil and was also 5 years removed from the passage of the Civil Rights Act. So race was certainly on the consciousness of America, but not in a positive way. It was people were afraid to deal with race, and they were troubled by it. So here we walk out on stage, and the mere fact that we were black and white caused us to be racial, whether we spoke anything about race at all. So it could be very difficult. I mean, it was violence sometime, it was laughter, it was pain, it was a lot of things, but through it all, we persevered, and we managed to have careers in the business.
Wow, I was so grateful to spend some time with those two gentlemen on Michigan Avenue. It was unbelievable. Confidence is what gets us through the day. Be forceful in your intent to do good things. Always keep your head up, and like I always say, be encouraged. That's Gerard McClendon live for tonight. You all have a blessed evening.
Ask or ask, Donda's rules, suit shoes. McClendonReport.com.